much more in detail at the NDACA. Sarah Dormer, who works with them at the moment, is going to be introduced, and also Tony, who already made it up here to talk about the origins of the whole thing. So here we go. Over to Sarah.
Hello, hello. And so first of all, thank you for coming today to learn about the students participating on the theme of disability arts. As we mentioned, this year, disability is collaborating with NDACA, which is the National Disability Arts Collection Archive. I've come along today to talk about a bit about this collaboration and to tell you a bit more about what the NDACA is and why it's important. So I'm learning also from NDACA. NDACA is led by Shape Arts, which is a disability-led arts organisation for the 40 industry. My role as a learning officer encompasses several elements of the project, such as running the NDACA Research and Development Scheme, which supports emerging disabled artists, disabled learners, designing the new learning facilities that will be located within Buckinghamshire University in High Wycombe, and working with Richard to create educational resources that can be shared as part of the institution. Tony, who supports already spoken this morning, is with me as the founder of NDACA. When I started at Shape Arts working on the NDACA project, Tony was still chief executive officer of Shape and is now chair, as you mentioned before. So before I get talking about the collaboration with UKDHM, I'll first introduce some other areas of the project, just to give it a context. So NDACA's research and development scheme, which I mentioned before, has emerging disabled artists with key positives to the NDACA, and facilitates mentoring sessions with the pair, as well as awarding each of the four emerging artists with a £4,000 grant. This year's NDACA R&D recipients are Aminda Durkee, Jack Ball, Mark Tamer, and Zara Jane Arnold. For more information about these exciting artists, you can find on the Shape Arts website and there's some photos of the group pairs together. So the NDACA is primarily a digital collection. Our archive is at its current and working over the last 3 years collecting artworks and ephemera belonging to the key participants of the disability arts movement. This material has been photographed, creating a digital archive that will be accessible online, and our website launches next April, by which time that will consist of over 2,000 images. And from April 2018 as well, Buckinghamshire University will host the NDACA Research Facilities, which is a unique resource for those wishing to learn more about disability arts history, and an important way to remind those who are familiar with this history about barriers to the arts and still against. These facilities will consist of a repository, a physical store of artworks that have been permanently donated to the collection, although the collection is mainly digital, we do have some physical artworks that have been donated to us as well. And a learning hub, which you can see an illustration of above. And this is going to be a space where you'll be able to see key pieces from the archive up close and access collections like the full series of Disability Arts and London magazine, which is a long running publication distributed by the London Disability Arts Forum. Great, so that brings me on to the collaboration between NDACA and Disability Month. So obviously, this year's theme of disability arts is very fitting for us. The theme of disability arts is extremely broad, obviously. And the NDACA resources focus primarily on work that was made from the mid-1970s onwards, in a period that we call the golden age of disability arts. And it's this period in particular which the NDACA has observed. During this time, obviously, as we mentioned earlier, there was a lot of activism and campaigning from disabled people and their life allies. A lot of this activism took form of artwork. So shortly, we will present the NDACA contribution to the educational resources available through the initiative's institutional pack. To make these four animations, we broke down the story of the golden age of the disability arts movement into three different themes. These are the social model of disability, which forms what we define as disability arts. Portraiture representation, which is a very important issue for many disabled artists, especially in respect to combating the negative effects of disability and disability within society. And the third theme is arts and activism, to highlight the power of culture and the ability arts has in both community and society. in itself is an important moment within the City Arts history. Collecting the heritage and journey into the City Arts is vital in the spirit of longevity. The lead animation showcase of the artwork we've collected to date and serve as an introductory point in which to showcase different elements of the City Arts history. The biographies and impacts provided alongside them, which you can find in your folders, serve to encourage students to further research those teachers in their animations. Before I do, I just wanted to bring out some testimonies. These come from people that I've worked with during the past year in my role when I've worked on various elements of the project. And for me, it's a reality that the story of the City Arts movement is often untold and unheard, and in doing so, highlights the importance of their own contributions. So I'll just read out those now. So Emily Lacarac is an architect in training, and she worked with me in designing the plan for what we're going to install in the university library, which is the plan we saw here. As a result of working with NDACA, I am much more engaged with and aware of accessibility issues, and take this into my own architectural practice and strive to innovate design with regards to all kinds of accessibility. Jessica Ryan-Nagowa, she founded her own organisation called Design for Disability, and we worked with her on designing some accessible furniture to have available in the learning centre as well. And she says, knowing that I've been able to take part in helping improve accessibility when it comes to a public communal space will fill me with joy and excitement. And finally, Annalisa Harding, who we've worked with as an access consultant and is a disability activist herself, says, NDACA serves such an important purpose by recognising the history and significance of disability arts. It's so important to see disabled artists and activists over decades that these images can be used to encourage disabled artists and activists today. They refer to the progress that